Good evening, everybody. So today we'll be discussing about time alignment. So mostly we have been dealing with data which is for example, you saw flower example, right? Rose versus jasmine versus lotuses. It was every flower corresponded to one tuple, like, or one vector, right? But never did you see a temporal evolution. For example, a video. For example, if I clap. If you just take one image, it is not sufficient to say that it is clapping, right? Similarly, if you take an example in the audio domain, if I am snapping my fingers, then this is not, if you just look at one small window, it is not going to contain that information. Similarly, if I make a gesture with hands, okay, like this, something like waving my hand, this you won't capture in one image, right? You will have to consider the temporal evolution, and speeds may vary. So this is the meaning of time alignment, that how do we align, or how do we take care of alignments in the time series? Okay, so consider this example. Oh, there is audio here, so let me see if I can use my microphone.
Hari. Hari.
Can you hear?
Hari. Hari.
Is it audible? So both these, both these utterances are the same sound, Hari, right? But if you take them as vectors, then you take a difference or the Euclidean distance. What is the Euclidean distance in this case? Very large, yes. But you know that there is just a slight shift in time, right? One is a little bit delayed as compared to other. Let us look at the next example now.
Hari.
What was it? So same or different? Huh?
Faster.
Yeah, but same word. Right? So, but still you see the waveform, how different they look. Right? Let's look at this example now. What do you expect this to be?
Hara.
This is different in Hara. So Hari versus Hara. So there are this top three are same Hari, but still the waveforms look very different. The bottom one is Hara, which looks similar to the first waveform, for example. Right? Okay. Tell me which of these are Hari and which are Hara. Raise your hands if you can make it out. I won't raise my hand. First four? Huh? First four are Hari? Looks like, yeah. Anybody else? Okay, all of them are Hari. Okay, let's see how can we do better. So here I am considering one very short window. If you look at this window, it is just, how long it is? 20 milliseconds window, right? This is one 20 milliseconds window. And from this window, I extract the magnitude spectrum and I plot the log of the magnitude spectrum. It looks like this. The log of the magnitude spectrum of this window looks like this. And similarly for this window, it looks like this. So this window is A sound, A, because Hari and Hara, they differ by A versus E. So I took the A sound here, just a short window, 25 milliseconds, plotted the log spectrum, it looks like this. And similarly for another instance of Hara, the A part, I took a short window, plotted the spectrum, log magnitude spectrum. Similarly for Hari, I took two different instances of E from Hari and I plotted the log spectrum. Looking at the spectrum, can you say they are more distinguishable in the spectral domain? Can you say the spectra are visually, it looks like they are easy to distinguish as compared to the waveforms? In the spectrum, you can see that in the R sound, the energy is distributed, if you consider them as energy, right, in different frequencies, right? What is energy? It is, what's energy? Square of the value, right? This is log, therefore you cannot talk of energy, but okay, consider it as without log, then it will be energy. And the energy is distributed across different frequencies. So up to, from 0 to 5000 Hertz. I took only 5000 Hertz because beyond this, I'm assuming that information is very less. Actually in the audio speech, even if you ignore above 5000 Hertz, it is still does not degrade the quality that much. Okay. So the distribution of energy in different frequencies in R is something like this, and in E it is something like this. Right? Therefore, log of magnitude spectrum can easily discriminate phonemes. Actually, somebody, one professor in MIT, he wrote a book on spectrogram reading. I'll tell you about that in a moment. So use binning for dimensionality reduction. On this, you can simply see that if you just create bins in frequency domain and just take energy in each bin or the log of energy in each bin, you can use that as a feature vector, right? And it can very easily discriminate between different phonemes. Okay, now if I plot the spectrogram, how will it look like? If I just take the R sound, the spectrogram looks like this. Another instance of R sound, spectrogram looks like this. And an instance of E sound, spectrogram looks like this. Another instance of E sound, spectrogram looks like this. Can you look at the spectrogram and easily visually discriminate between R and E? Right? Why? Because E sound has a lot of gap here, right? A lot of gap here, but R sound doesn't have that gap. So using the spectrum or the spectrogram, which are basically different spectrogram or different spectra shifted by time. If you take different windows shifted by time and plot the spectra in the vertical direction, you get spectrogram. Okay. So looking at the spectrogram, you can distinguish R versus E. So I was telling there was a professor in MIT. He wrote a book. It's called Acoustic Phonetics, and that book is like this much thick. I think about, if I remember correctly, I don't know, maybe 1,000 pages or something like that. 1,000 pages book, and it's all about how to read the spectrogram. And he could read it, and also how to make rules by which we can distinguish between spectra, whether it's coming from this phoneme or that phoneme or this consonant, vowel, everything, right? Just by looking at the spectrum, you can make some simple handmade rules and you can do speech recognition. That book kind of worked in that direction. But unfortunately, it never worked out because the actual variation in running speech is so much, you cannot make handmade rules. And he himself acknowledged that, no, it is not possible. In running speech, it's not possible. So these instances of R and E are idealized versions because I recorded them in isolation and I am plotting them. But if you see the running speech, it's very difficult to distinguish. Okay, but this was just to give an idea that still the magnitude spectrum is a better way to represent phonemic information, which phoneme it is, right? Okay, now why I am discussing about speech is to tell you the importance of temporal information, right? Speech is not just one snapshot. It is evolving over time. So temporal information is important, right? So today we'll be discussing primarily about information which is evolving with time. It can be speech, it can be videos, it can be different sounds. You recorded some sounds in your for your assignments. It could be those sounds. Or what else? Where each sample will be evolving over time. Any examples you can give? I gave example of clapping. Right? If you look at the images or the video, the clapping video, just one image can't tell you, but you have to look at the entire sequence to be able to tell, okay, it's a clapping video. Jumping or any action, dancing. Okay. So there are different. So you have to find patterns, not statically, but dynamically evolving. Ultimately, machine learning is all about pattern recognition, right? You're finding patterns. And here you have to find pattern which is evolving with time. It is not static. So information is distributed over time, or dynamical information. This, okay. Now let us look at one small aspect of that variation with respect to time, which is called shifting in time. We saw this example of Hari. These two are same audio, both are Hari, but they are shifted little bit by time, in time, by a small delay, right? Similarly, in this example, a simpler toy example, you have the same information but which is shifted temporally. How can you define a distance metric between the two? Okay, open question for you. How can you define a distance metric where you want to ignore temporal shift? Pardon? Correlation. But correlation is a vector. You want to find a metric which is a scalar. You want to find a metric between these two vectors. Okay, these are two vectors. And you want to find a metric between them. You know that it should be zero. The distance should be zero because you know they are same patterns, just shifted in time. So how will you define a metric which is a scalar which will capture this distance? Somebody was saying something. No? You know the answer. You all have read that. You're very close. Answer which you give is very close, but just think harder. How will you get a scalar, not a vector? Distance cannot be a vector, right? Distance should be a scalar metric. Take a norm of. Do you think it will work? Huh? Good, yes. So you take the peak or the max value, maximum correlation, right? You take maximum correlation. You compute the autocorrelation thing, or sorry, the cross correlation, and you take the maximum of it. Don't take norm, but take the max. Yeah, you normalize it somehow. You normalize it with the energies. Yeah, true. So you take correlation, sorry. You can take cross correlation between x1 and x2. These are vectors. Which means basically, okay, the covariance between the two divided by the variance of individual under root, right? Okay. So this is about shifting. So yes, you know some way to take care of shifting. How about this? What are these two different sounds? Okay, let me play it for you.
Hari.
What was it?
Hari.
What was that? So this is called stretching. So temporally we can stretch. Somebody can say Hari very fast. Somebody can say Hari. Or some people speak slowly. Some people speak fast. how do you take care of this pattern? Somebody can wave hand like this, somebody can wave hand like this, both are hand waving, both are same class. So how will you take care of temporal stretching? Right? Similarly, somebody can sing slowly, somebody can sing very fast. I mean, somebody sings at a faster pace, somebody sings at a lower tempo. How do you take care of these aspects? So there are many, many examples of shifting in, stretching in time. Okay, so how do you take care of stretching? We'll discuss a little later. Let us take a simple example. This is a scalar time series. X1 is simply 0001230. X2 is 0123000. Both are same, both contain same information, but just with a little bit time delay. Consider that this is the time dimension. This dimension is a temporal dimension, right? Now, how do you match the two? You have already told that you take the cross correlation and you take the maximum value of cross correlation, right? So, maximum of cross correlation. You can also take difference, right? Shifted difference, like you take the difference, shift little bit, then take the difference, shift little bit, take the, instead of multiplying, in cross correlation you multiply the shifted versions. Similarly, you can do difference, then shifted version of difference. That is also a valid measure, right? So you can take min of shifted difference or delayed difference. And the good thing about this measure is it also takes care of noise. Even if your patterns are not exactly same, they have high correlation. If there is noise, little bit noise, then again there will be high correlation. So that is also a good property. Now, how do you align stretched time series? And this stretching may not be uniform. Like some vectors could be stretched for longer as compared to others. Like when I say hurry, generally the consonants remain of same length. Like if I say hurry, the r part, the consonant will be almost of same length, but the vowels, they get elongated, right? When you sing also, vowels only you elongate. You cannot elongate the consonants because consonants are generally bursts. Some consonants, yes, you can elongate, like sir. I can say sir for as long as I want, but some like k, I cannot make it long. I can only make the a part long, k. It can be like the can be made longer, but the k part cannot be made longer, right? So it is very non-uniform, and this is an example. How do you take care of stretched time series? Any ideas? Any wild guesses? Append zeros and take difference, but how will that take care of time stretching in time series? How much should I stretch? But that should be computationally very expensive. No? I can keep on doing it for infinite time, expecting to find an optimal solution. But can you do it optimally, computationally viable? Moving average. Okay, so which one should I move? Okay, let's say I take x1, the first element of x1, and I move it over the entire x2. Okay, I take a small window here. Let's say I take this window. How long? Tell me a value. 3, okay, let's take 3. Okay, then? Okay, I take an average of this window, which will be 2 by 3. Okay? But if you do the similar thing on the other sequence as well, like this one also you pull, your whole thing is going to spoil, isn't it? If you take a window on both the sequences, like both will be equally dilated or compressed, right? How will that take care of? In the Fourier domain, same as time shifting. Why? Yeah, shape of one window will remain same, but that shape is repeating over time, right? That shape will repeat over time. How will you find cross correlation between two sequences? Earlier you found cross correlation in the two sequences, it was able to find the perfect match because there was no stretching, right? If you look at this example, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Somewhere, so the pattern here, the pattern is 1, 2, 3. So that is able to match. But in this case, the pattern is not 1, 2, 3. Pattern is, 1 is a pattern, 2 is an individual pattern, 3 is an individual pattern. Okay, there is like a hierarchy of patterns. 1 is a pattern which is matching, but then each one can be stretched. So cross-correlation won't work here. Means the exact same sequence won't match. If I can have like 10 times 2 here, I can insert 10 times 2 also, isn't it? It's non-uniform stretching, so I could stretch 2 10 times, 3 also 10 times. How will you match them? Yeah, so in discrete case, yes, you can remove the redundant elements, but in continuous case, you won't know. But yeah, this is a good choice, a good idea to remove redundancy. Yes. Okay. In this example, I'm considering only single element is repeated multiple times, and the patterns are not repeating. Okay. Let us. Once again. You are saying that I shift x1 by 1 unit and then take the difference element wise or of the element wise and then? Okay, the points where it is 0, so I will find some points will be 0, but most of the points will not be 0, then? Repeated elements, yes. So you are very close to the solution, you are able to think in the right direction. Maybe I will kind of help you with that. So what you do is, you construct a similarity matrix, so to say. Let us say one sequence is 0, 1, 1, 1, 2, 3, 0, 0. Another one is 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, right? This is what we wrote. So if I consider this, the similarity of this with all of these, so what will that be then? Let's consider the difference. So difference is here. Here the difference will be 0. Here the difference will be, now this one, difference is 1, here the difference is, oh I think here I have, while drawing this, I have considered only 5 elements, so which means this is not there, okay, this was not there, okay, let me remove it from here. This is 1, this is 2. And here again, same thing will repeat. So if you kind of draw this, it will become something like this. So black one is 0, and white one is the largest value, which is 3 in this case. So this is 3, this is 0, this is 1, right? So the color is kind of coding the information. Now, now you can find the best match. So you can say this 0 is matching this 0, then this 1 is matching this 1, and this 1 is also matching this 1. So it's kind of you're trying to find the best path which where the differences are minimum. So you define a cost which is accumulated sum of these differences, and wherever it is minimum, you say, okay, I found the best path, and you whatever elements you met on the path, they will tell you the similarity, right? For example, this one is similar to this one. This one is will match all three of these. You can consider any one of them. This two will match this two. This three will match this three. So in this way, by finding the best paths in this matrix, you can find an alignment. And how will you find the metric now? How will you find the metric? Yes, the total distance, sum of the distance along this minimum path. That is your shortest distance between these two sequences, right? So that is your distance metric. So this method can take care of shift as well as stretching, right? Both can be taken care of by this method. Question? Yes, so it is known by many names. The general framework is called dynamic programming, and the variations or the different kinds of variations of it are added distance, dynamic time warping, Viterbi algorithm, so many variations. But okay, the basic idea is this. So I'm just telling the basic idea, which is very intuitive, right? But there's a constraint. The constraint you have defined that you cannot go backwards. Like if you are going in this direction, you cannot go back either in the y direction or in the x direction. You cannot go back. You have to go from top to bottom only. You can go left, right, and up. So you can go right or bottom or diagonally bottom right. But you cannot go left or up. Right? That is the constraint which you have given. You can do away with this constraint also, but then the search will become very inefficient. But if you put this constraint, then you can see the search is very efficient. You just compute the distance metric and then just do it. Okay, so I'm going through the detailed algorithm now. The algorithm says dynamic time warping. You have given two time series x1 and x2. Okay, this is what you got in the beginning. X1 is a time series, x2 is a time series. Define the cost as point-wise difference. You can also use cross-correlation, normalized version, so that you don't mess up. But since I have considered them as scalar values, so cross-correlation won't make sense. Like cross-correlation between two scalars does not make much sense, right? So better is to use difference function, Euclidean distance, let us say. So define the cost as point-wise difference. So your Dij is a matrix whose elements are the ith element of x1 minus the jth element of x2. So going back to the figure for intuitive understanding, so I took the ith element of x1 minus the jth element of x2. So I will vary over this entire length, and j will vary over this entire length. So your total number of computations involved will be how much? Mn, yeah. So if you take this as capital I, this is capital J, then it is capital I into capital J, right? Or if you take Mn, that is Mn. So you compute this matrix Dij. Once you compute this matrix, now you have to find the cost over the path. You have to find the path over which, if you add, the cost will be minimum, because the cost is the distance that you want to minimize the distance. So the way I write it mathematically is like this. So d of pi is the path. how do you save a path? So one simple way is you say here I1 J1 comma this is your pi. The pi matrix or pi vector. The pi vector is simply the path. So ij of each node. Node means this cell where you. So this cell is in your path. So this path, I will write it like this. So I will write pi is equal to. Yeah, please tell me. First is 0,0. Next is 1,1. Next is 2,1. Next is 3,1. Next is 4,2. And in this way, I keep going until I reach this point, which will be 4,7 or 7,4. Right? So this is my pi vector. And this is my D matrix. Okay. So, sorry, not capital D, but small D matrix. Now, what is my capital D? Capital D is the sum along this path. Now, this is a difficult problem, difficult to find optimal paths. If I do not have any constraints, that is why we have already discussed this point that we will introduce some constraints like transitions. Move only one node left. Right, or I'm sorry, this is not left, down, pardon, one node down or one node right or diagonally downwards, diagonally kind of down right, right? So these are the three directions which are possible. At every node or every cell, you can only go in three directions. You cannot go back, you cannot go up. So mathematically, ik, the value of I at the kth node should be greater than or equal to ik minus 1, and jk should be greater than or equal to jk minus 1. Okay. Now how do I find the optimal path? So there is something called Bellman's optimality principle, which says that the optimal path, let us say I want to find out the optimal path from 0 to k, from 0 to kth node. For example, let me show it. I give you this matrix D. Now you want to find the best path. So you have to start from this node 0,0, right? You start from here, and here the distance is anyway 0. Now you have to make a move in three possible directions, either here or here or here, right? The Bellman's optimality principle will say that your next optimal node, wherever it is, it will satisfy this property. This property that the cost from 0 to k is equal to the cost. So basically, you know, this is true for always. Cost from 0 to k minus 1 plus the cost at the kth node, right? The cost to go to kth node. And on optimal path, this is the Bellman's optimality principle, which says the optimal path, you just take optimal value of this, optimal value of this, and the optimal value of this. So let us say I started from here. I reached up till this k minus 1th point. Now the optimal path up till k minus 1 point plus the next optimal jump, right? This D is the next one, D at pi k, the next one, wherever is the minimum, if you jump onto that node, that will be the optimal path from 0 to kth node. Is this clear? Mathematically, this looks very weird, but intuitively, I know you all understand it. Right? That the, so basically, you are breaking down your optimization problem, going from 0 to kth step. You first find 0 to k minus 1 and then iteratively find the kth. Just local optimization. So this is a greedy search algorithm. It's very greedy, right? It is because why it is greedy, anybody can give explanation or anybody can give their understanding of greedy. Four. Yeah, so you are giving a very abstract answer that your local optima, you are always optimizing locally, but it might not be global optima, right? So whenever you want to give a very graphic example, take extreme cases. So I will give you one extreme case, which is something like this. Let us say, okay, let me draw a matrix. I don't know if I can draw it, but let me see. So there is one path, which is, let's say you want to reach I think 3 cross 3 won't be sufficient. Okay, let us say I want to reach from here to here. This is 0, and let us say this is 0, this is 1, this is 1. Where will I go? Let me take the red pen and draw the best path. Diagonal. Now, let us say this is 5, 5, 5, and this is again 0. Where will you go now? Okay, let me make this as 6. Where will you go now? Diagonal. Then, now from here, again, what is the total cost? Huh? 5. So this is what you will get, right? If you use that principle. But let us take another possibility. What do you get now? If I take orange. If I take this path. What is my D? Right? So my local solutions were not the best solutions. This is called a greedy approach. Greedy approach will get a value 5 because it is optimizing the local optimization problem. But a global approach will find the best path possible. Okay, but Bellman's optimality principle is greedy in that sense. Okay. So dynamic time warping gives us a way to define a metric for time series. Right? Now you know how to compare two different time series with what things are possible, either a shift or stretching. But you cannot turn it around, right? That is still not there because we are allowing only there are local constraints, you can go in one direction.
You can only define the difference between two sets. So classify, you generate x and y axis. One x axis is going to be a distance matrix with respect to p, and distance matrix with respect to r. So, but what will be that signal that you will consider as the base?
Okay, good question. We'll come to this actually in this slide only. Okay. So DDW gives us a way to define a metric for time series, right? Now you know how to find distance between two different time series. You know one good way. We can use this for recognizing sequences, say speech recognition. As you mentioned, like classification, I want to classify E versus R. Then I will use template matching. I will take a standard sound of E. It could be any sound, right? I took a sound of E. And whenever a test case comes, I'll just compare that sound with this sound. Right? That's what you do in which case? In nearest neighbor search. K nearest neighbor search. Did we study that? No. Nearest neighbor basically means, okay, if I give you five sampler or exemplar E sounds and five template R sounds, like five templates for E. Different people have spoken in different ways E, and I'm saying that this is all the possible ways in which people can speak E. Assume hypothetically, these are the five ways in which people can speak E. These are five ways in which people can speak R. Whenever your test sound comes, you compare the distance from all these 10, whichever is the minimum, you assign it to that class. That is called K nearest neighbor, or the nearest neighbor approach. You find the nearest neighbor and then just assign it to that class. So that is template matching in this case. You are formulating some best templates for E, some best templates for R. Whenever your test case comes, you match to one of those and you are done. So this is this was a good method of speech recognition some time ago. But this is a valid method to do speech recognition. But of course, you cannot recognize very general sentences. You have to match only known words like yes or no or digits, a very limited vocabulary, because for each word you have to create a template, right? And this approach is still used for some very niche applications. How many of you have used Duolingo? How many of you have heard of Duolingo? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, not bad. It's a language learning app, Duolingo, made by CMU students. They were students and they made this app and they opened a company, Duolingo. So this Duolingo, so they use this technology, template matching kind of technology, to find if you are pronouncing correctly or not. Let's say I go to learn French. They give me a word to pronounce. I will pronounce in some way. How do you know whether I am pronouncing correctly or not? So they have some templates from teachers and they just do matching, and then from that they can tell whether you are pronouncing correctly. If the score is, or the total distance is less than a threshold, they will say okay, you pass, otherwise you fail, right? Very basic approach to do this kind of classification of correct pronunciation versus wrong pronunciation. Okay, and we discussed it's the variants of DDW are edit distance, VW algorithm. In general, it is called dynamic programming. Dynamic programming is a big set of problems, but this DDW falls in that category. Okay, audio classification. This is for your next assignment, which has been posted. Some things are still remaining. I will modify that assignment a little bit because I have to give you some objective measures that how I'm going to evaluate the assignment. As of now, it is a little vague in that sense. So I'll be updating that assignment. I will email you whenever. But you can start working on it. Problems won't change, but just that the format in which you submit, only that will change. And the deadline is very hard. I'm not going to move it. So start working right now, because every time you start working on the last day and then ask for an extension, that is not acceptable. That is very obvious you're starting on the last day. Okay. So this time, no extension. It's a hard deadline. Pardon? Okay. Audio classification. So this again, you can use your audio as a time series. Consider it as a time series of spectra. Each spectrogram can be seen as time series of spectra. Then you find patterns in, now where you find patterns? One way is you can do classification by pooling, which means you consider each spectrum as one pattern, or as you are trying to find patterns in your spectrums, not the temporal information. You are ignoring your evolution of windows, but just single spectrum. You look at it and you say, "This is, I am trying to find patterns in this," like the way we did here in our this example. If I consider single spectrum, and I consider I am trying to find patterns in single spectra, right? This is what I mean. If I give you an E sound and R sound, you will just okay. Let's go back to yes. So estimate the probability for each class for a particular spectrum, right? Or the one point in your time series, and then use pooling to estimate the class of X, right? How can you pool? Let us say this was my spectrogram. This was my spectrogram, like series of spectra put together. For this one, I estimate this is speech. For this one, I estimate this is speech. This one, speech. This one, silence. This one, silence. And all of these are silence, basically. Then you can do a pooling. You can either do a majority voting. Oh, sorry, speech. Because silence is not a class, let us say. It's either, because silence will be everywhere, right? So it should be either speech or music or background noise. If you want to make silence as a class, then it should be, then everything should be just silence, right? You cannot have little bit silence and then speech. You cannot call that as silence. So majority vote will give you speech. There can be some misclassification also. Okay, let us say this one comes out to be music, right? Because of some misclassification. But still, the majority of spectra will say we belong. Our pattern looks like that of speech, so you can call it as speech very conveniently. So you can either do majority voting, or you can, if you have soft scores, you can do max pooling, right? You can, if this one has some scores, you average all the scores or take the maximum of all the scores. So all these kinds of pooling you can do. Am I making sense? Am I going too fast? It makes sense, right? It's very intuitive. Okay. So what are the drawbacks in this? The drawback is that you lose temporal information. For example, clapping, or in audio, in videos, you lose temporal information. Now, how do you incorporate temporal information? You have a neural network, or you have a linear classifier, or you have NMF classifier. How will you incorporate temporal information into this? Right?
Memory
feedback. Feedback what?
Memory storing.
Your models have no memory. Neural networks have no memory. Do they have memory? Okay, let us say whatever you have studied until now. Whatever models you have studied, they have no memory, if I am not wrong. You have studied linear classifiers, you have studied, what have you studied? Neural networks, NMF, PLCA, PCA, they are for like data deformation induction, and then you can use classifiers. They have no memory. How will you introduce temporal information into it? Okay, no ideas? One simple is use n-grams, means you use, let's say, three patterns together, three spectra together. Make one vector which is three vectors long, or three spectra long. Concatenate three spectra to form one vector. Then it contains information from three consecutive spectra, right? Not clear? No? Clear? Yes? No? Okay, what I mean to say is, let us say, you are clapping, right? I'm clapping. Instead of taking one picture, if I give you three consecutive pictures, can you say my hand is moving in this direction or that direction? From there, can you tell it's probably clapping, right? So that is the idea. Use n-grams. N-grams means you use consecutive vectors and make them as one super vector or one vector. Or you can augment deltas, which means you take one vector and you augment or you append the difference of that vector from the previous vector. For example, your hand is moving, if you take pixel differences, or you're speaking, then you are in speech, you take the difference of this spectrum minus this spectrum. So you see, okay, your spectrum is here, but it's kind of velocity information, right? Just like in physics, you have velocity. Don't just consider the position, but also the velocity. So if I append the two together, it will give you temporal information. You can also incorporate, acceleration, right? That will give you the rate of change, so rate of change, right? Still, these capture only highly local temporal information. You can capture like consecutive 3-4 vectors. Okay, somebody can say, I can take 100 vectors together and that will capture the entire information. What is the drawback there? What is the problem there? I take 100 vectors and concatenate them together and then I build my classifier. What is the problem? Complexity. Complexity will increase so much, right? That is complexity based, your network, your patterns will become very, very difficult to train because data will be less and you need lots of data to train your model, so many parameters. Search space is very huge. In the last class, we discussed curse of dimensionality that will come into play. Can we do better? Yes, one way is CNNs. As I just mentioned, the curse of dimensionality, it led us to CNNs. So whenever you have higher dimensionality and correlated locally correlated information, you use CNNs, you use kernels to find those local correlations. Yes, you can use CNNs. And if you use deep networks or deep CNNs, layers of CNNs, then one layer will find locally, next layer will find a little bit more widely. Did you see those lectures? Were you able to see those lectures? Watch them carefully. They are part of the syllabus. Don't ignore them. And in there, I have discussed how when you go from one layer to another layer, your field of view, how much information can you see? It keeps increasing based on your kernel width and your stripes and everything. Then, okay, another way is, as Nishant pointed out, that you modify your neural networks or models to have memory in them, models which can remember the dynamic information, with models with memory. So some examples are recurrent neural networks, and LSTMs is a kind of RNN, which is very popular, long short-term memory networks. So we will study them in the next class, probably. Thank you. Thank you.